So tell me why we're divided.
On to the Way to the World podcast, episode number 2. I am Wade, and this is my son Philip, our producer and editor and co-host of this podcast. So we welcome you to another Saturday. We got a lot to talk about today. Let me get my mic up here so I can do that. Okay, we got a lot to talk about today. As most of y'all know, we had a big Supreme Court decision on yesterday. I don't remember what time. I think it was in the afternoon. I believe it was in the afternoon. And
yeah, it was.
And it kind of rocked the United States, for lack of a better term. And so we're going to talk about it today. That'll probably be the mainstay of this podcast for today. normally we delve into different types of subjects, but today I believe that Supreme Court ruling kind of trumps everything. So for all of you that don't know, and it's got to be very few, the United States Supreme Court overturned Roe versus Wade, as well as I think there's a case called Casey versus somebody. I can't remember off the top of my head, but it was both of them. Which basically what it does, and the media will tell you different things, it does not get rid of abortion. So let's just go ahead and say that now. For all y'all that wants abortion and believe in abortion and all those things, you can still do it. You just have to find which state will allow you to do it. So basically what happened is that the Supreme Court overturned Roe versus Wade, which means the federal government is out of the abortion business and has given the power back to the states, which is where it belongs. Our system of government gives the states the power to do most everything, for the most part. And that's where the power belongs, in the states, where the voters and those governors can decide what's good for their state. So this Supreme Court ruling does not stop abortions. There are states that will continue to do them, mainly on the West Coast and in the Northeast. But this decision does get the federal government out of the abortion business. Abortion is no longer legal on the federal level, with potentially the only exception being the Native American reservations, if they choose to do so. I believe they have a little bit more autonomy. Somebody in the comments can correct me, but I believe they'll be the exception, because obviously Native American treaties and whatnot is a little complicated, and so it may be a little different with them. But other than that, there are a bunch of states that have what they call trigger laws that have already went to effect since yesterday. Others will be within 30 days or several days, depending on their attorney generals. So you could pretty much guess, I'd say about 25 states will be against, will make it a felony to get an abortion. That includes prison time and fines with various amounts, but pretty high amounts. And approximately half the nation will still allow them. So, in getting that basic synopsis down, we're going to have our opinions on today, and then we'll be through. My son just told me he spent a good portion of the night watching various people talk about the ruling. I didn't spend as much time. Just to give you my opinion, then I'll hand it off to Philip. As Christians and saints, we are supposed to be pro-life, period. Now, I know there are Christians and saints out there that believe in abortion. They believe in a women's right to choose. And okay, that's fine. But in the end, all an abortion was the mass genocide and murder of babies, unborn babies. And in fact, the state of California is trying to pass a law that will allow you to kill the baby after birth. So this is this ruling here, you know, depending on which part of the debate you stand on, is a victory for people who believe in life. Not choice, but life. Because in the end, this ruling doesn't negate a woman's choice to have an abortion. It just means you have to go to another state if you don't live in a state that's where it's legal. Or black market, because of course that's what's going to happen. You know, your choice. You still have a choice to, you know, kill that baby inside you. You just have to either go to another state or go black market. I believe that as a church as a whole, regardless of what your color is or whatever political side of the spectrum you're on, you should have been for this ruling. One, because it gets the federal government out of the abortion business. And two, that it will not stop, but it will slow down the mass genocide of millions of babies, predominantly African-American, or I should say black babies, who are disproportionately affected by abortion. And it lessens the profit that Planned Parenthood and these clinics get for doing abortions. Because like any business, it's a profit business. Let's be real about it. Hospitals are run by profit. Everything we do in society, there's profit behind it, unless you're a nonprofit organization. And even with a nonprofit, there's profit behind it.
Yeah.
Okay. But, so again, this is not going to stop abortions. It doesn't make them illegal in states that deem that they want to continue to do that. That's your choice as a state. And that's the way it's supposed to be. The Constitution never said it was the federal government's job to make sure that a woman can kill a baby, regardless if you were raped, whether you had sex without a condom, whether whatever. There's nothing in the Constitution that says that abortions were, you know, anything the federal government. The federal government gives you life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Well, abortion takes life away, last time I checked. Now, most states that are going to make abortion a felony will allow abortions only in the case of saving the mother's life, or in some states, rape, you know, rape and those type of things. And again, that's the state's choice. That's where the power is supposed to be. Now, we know that the Supreme Court are judges that are appointed by the president and confirmed by the Senate. The argument is, oh, well, they're not elected officials. That's not what they are in the first place. As judges, they've been elected up until a certain point. That after a certain point, you are appointed. The higher, you know, when you get to the federal level, you're appointed, not elected. So I guess some people feel that they, because they're not elected officials, that the people didn't have sway or influence. That's a lie. The Planned Parenthood and pro-choice movement had plenty of power, plenty of money, and plenty of people to defend its position. And I'm sure they were there to defend their position as a Supreme Court. So let's just get that out the way right now. And vice versa. The pro-life people have the same thing. These type of things have been decided by Supreme Courts for 100 plus years. It just so happens that this law that was came into effect back in the 70s, I think the early 70s, if I remember correctly. 73. The year I was born. Thank God my mother decided to have me and not abort me. And I've been around about 50 years. Mm-hmm. Almost about 50 years. And now is gone on the federal level. And this is the way government should be. That the states, in most cases, should dictate what is good for their citizens that live in their state. the federal government is should be limited in what it does as a federal government. Obviously, national defense, trade, those type of things, and even states can do its own trade, but they regulate it. So there is a role for every part of government. Now, I've heard, and I'm sure Philip will when he comes and gives his opinion here, many talk about pro and con, about interpretation. I heard a lot about interpretation and how, you know, each Supreme Court, depending on who's on there, interprets the Constitution differently. And that's their job, to interpret the Constitution. That's their job. That's what they're appointed to do. Interpret the Constitution to the best of their ability. They're supposed to keep politics out of it, but we know they don't. And this ruling opens the door for a lot of things. If you think this is the last you'll hear of it, you're sleeping somewhere. Because this is only the beginning. Yes, this gets the federal government out of the baby killing business, out of the mass genocide of babies. The millions and millions of unborn babies that potentially could have changed our country as we know it. Mm-hmm. All of the potential that those babies potentially could have had has been snuffed out, mostly because people had unprotected sex and didn't want the baby. They weren't accountable for that life, at least on the woman's side, accountable for that life in their stomach, and on the men's side, not accountable to let the woman know that I'm going to stay here with you and help you take care of that child. Because guess what? Men are affected by this ruling too. This is not just a woman's issue. Men are just as much at fault as the women are. In fact, I would say more so, Phil, because we're in a leadership role. Men are responsible because it takes two to make a baby. As we learned in biology, as you learned in biology, as I learned in biology, and most folk that'll view this learned in biology, it takes two to make a baby. Or at least it takes the sperm from a man to hook up with the egg, and then that produces a child as we know it. Now, whether you have it the natural way or you have it by, lab, it doesn't matter. That's still how a baby is made. It takes two. X and Y. Okay? But the problems I see with this, one, is that people are just going way bonkers over it.
Yeah.
Because they believe it's the end of abortion, and it's not. We have to keep repeating ourselves because this ruling does not stop abortions. It only takes it down to the state level. Now, if you happen to live in a state, mainly in the South, in the Midwest, that's going to make abortion a felony, then you may want to move somewhere else. You know, and some people are like, well, that's not a choice. Yeah, it is a choice. If you're that hard up on not having children, or if you accidentally have one or whatever, and you don't want to have it, then that means you got to move somewhere else. It's just that simple. Yeah, it may not be simple, and we don't know everybody's financial situations. That's not what we're talking about. That's none of our business. But you're talking about choice, and choice means that you have a choice to move to a state that will fall in line with your beliefs on abortion. So if you don't like that your state is going to make it a felony, then move somewhere else. It's just that simple. It's just that simple. And I'm just talking about the choice, not necessarily the means to make the choice. That's a whole separate issue. That's none of my business. But all these ladies are talking about you taking our choice away. No, they haven't. They just moved it to the state level. That's all they did. That's all this ruling did, is got the federal government out of the business, which it never belonged to in the first place. But we know everybody has a different interpretation. And from a Christian perspective, that's why this is a hot topic too, because churches don't want to touch this, and the churches that do get a little too fanatical about it, in my opinion. And I've heard a lot blame white evangelicals for their view on this. And yes, some of them have a radical view. And if they don't have a radical view, they don't know how to convey the right view. And I've seen the black church mix. Some agree with abortions and some don't. So you can see that even the church has a problem because of interpretation. A lot of what we do is how we interpret things. And we have people that are sitting on the Supreme Court that interpret the Constitution in the way that they feel it should be interpreted. And depending on who's sitting on there, we'll interpret it differently. It just so happens that six of those Supreme Court judges agreed with the interpretation that Roe versus Wade was unconstitutional. And three didn't. Okay, majority rules. And then I've heard the argument, well, we don't, you know, this, you know, but we live in a democracy. No, we don't. Go back to government class. We are not a democracy and never have been. People use that word so just it willy-nilly, it's ridiculous. We are not a democracy and never have been. And if you've been taught that, that teacher lied to you. Your parents lied to you. Whoever taught you lied to you. We are not a democracy. We are a representative republic, meaning that you are represented by somebody else to represent your views and your positions in government. You elect people to represent you. Now, we understand there are a whole lot of politicians, or what they are, politicians, and for the most of them are liars on both sides of the aisle. Let's be real about it. They're out for their own self-interest. Very few of our elected representatives actually represent us, especially on the federal level. Now, you'll find more people do that as you get lower down the ladder, state level and municipalities. You have a lot more representation when you get down to the city level or the municipality level. My son would tell you, because he works for a city. You get a lot more representation when you go to your city council meeting than you would if you were to try to call your congressman in D.C. In fact, you might not even be able to get in touch with your congressman in D.C. So we understand that politicians have their place, but for the most part, a lot of them are liars, they're thieves, and they're out for their own self-interest. But yet we put them in office, and we're all guilty of it. They tell us a good story. We take it hook, line, and sinker, and we put them in office. And so in reality, voting is the better of two evils, really, in my opinion. Regardless if you're a Democrat or a Republican or an independent, so I should say the better of three evils, because sometimes they do have an independent candidate on there. You just got to vote the better of three evils. And that's a horrible decision to have to make, because it shouldn't be that way. You should believe in your elected representatives, because that's the type of government we have. And for right now, it's the best government we have. It's totally imperfect because people run it. And when people run things, it's imperfect. Only God is perfect. And so for those people that make this argument about it's a democracy. No, we're not a democracy. So please get that out your heads. Go back to school, because you obviously didn't learn nothing in government class. We are a representative republic. Means that we elect a representative to represent us as the people. We do not have a direct democracy. In fact, I don't know of any country in the world that's a direct democracy. No. And in fact, I believe the founding fathers, as flawed as they were, believe that direct democracy would not work, because there are too many cons and not enough pros.
Right.
So many
people.
They picked the best government to suit what they felt would be a government that could last. And again, they were flawed. The Constitution said that everybody's created equal. We know they weren't, because some of them went right back to their houses with slaves in them. So it wasn't the people. It was their intent, regardless if they were hypocrites or not, because they were. Let's just be honest. They were. They were hypocritical. What they believed is not necessarily what they did. So basically, they were like, do as I say and not as I do. And I don't believe that. I believe we should be doing do as I do. You follow by example. That's what I meant to say. And so for them, what they put on paper was the ideal representation of a government, regardless if they were living it. because some of them weren't living. Some of them had slaves. Thomas Jefferson, George Washington. We can name probably almost all the people that were on that Continental Congress probably had slaves, for the most part. Not all, but most. At least all of them that lived in the South. The southern part of the colonies.
I think Alexander Hamilton had
slaves. Well, again, right. There were a few that didn't have slaves, but a lot of them from Virginia and those areas all had slaves. All of them. Okay, we know Washington did. President Washington did. We know President Jefferson did. We know a lot of them did. Okay? But the simple fact of the matter is the Constitution is what it is. It's our founding document, is what our government is supposed to come from. But unfortunately, what's happened is that, and I heard this from a gentleman that I watch on YouTube, that the country leans on the Constitution instead of wraps itself around. And I thought that was a real good analogy, because a lot of what we do is supposed to be wrapped in the Constitution, not leaned against it. Because when you lean against something, you're really not all in it. You're just leaned against it. But when you wrap yourself around it, you're surrounded by it. You know what I'm saying? It surrounds you. And that's what's supposed to happen. Now, of course, over the years, we've gotten further and further and further away from that. Now, well, before I move on, let's get Philip into this conversation, because he's just itching to get in here. So Philip, you obviously, heard what happened, yesterday, and, we'd be curious to know from your generational perspective, because this is probably the biggest thing that's ever happened in my generation. Okay. Because this thing was created at the beginning of my life, but you got a lot of many, many years. There may be more things to come in your generation, but this is the biggest thing that's happened in my generation. So give us your perspective from your generational point of view.
Well, I've been trying to think about how I should format this. So I'm going to just start off by giving my opinion about the Roe v. Wade overturning.
Okay.
Now, as a young Christian man that doesn't just follow Christianity as a moral practice, but actually practicing what's said in the Bible,
all right,
I feel as if the overturning was good in my sense of view of the world and how I practice and move about, okay, in my life, because I wouldn't have to worry about abortion, or young ladies shouldn't have to worry about abortion if they were living the life of a Christian young lady or woman, because mm-hmm. you're not even supposed to have
okay.
intercourse until you're married. And then when you're married, you're not even supposed to have abortions either, because when you're married, you're supposed to have intercourse to procreate. That's what the Bible says.
All right, I got it.
Hallelujah.
Okay.
All right. So that's my stance on that. And okay. I'm going to just leave it there on one sentence. But
okay,
I think people are getting misunderstood about what this really means, and I'm trying to clear it up as much as possible. People are over here arguing about the people in the Supreme Court
mm-hmm.
when you should be happy that the people in the Supreme Court left it in literally more of your hands.
Correct.
It would be different if they overturned it on the federal level. Now it's banned everywhere across America when it's not. They gave it to the states, meaning that you as a citizen can go out there and vote for the representative that you believe can overturn abortion in your state. It's not a Supreme Court problem. It's not definitely not a presidential problem, or it's a your problem now.
Right.
They changed it. They didn't change the abortion law, they changed who decides the abortion law, and that's you. So I don't understand why a lot of people...
That's a mic drop right there.
I don't understand why a lot of people are complaining. If you go down, that means if they gave it down to the state level, we live in Alabama, so of course abortion is going to be illegal here. But I've seen people in Oregon and California protesting about pro-choice in Oregon and California.
It doesn't affect them.
Right. It's going to be legal to the highest extent. So this all comes back down to a voting thing. I talked to the mayor of Montgomery a couple of weeks ago, and he said only 23% of people in Alabama voted for the general election. for the senator, the people who decide on if you want abortion in this state.
You're talking about the runoff election we just had a couple days ago.
That one and the one before.
And the big, okay, gotcha.
Actually just the one before. That's the one we talked about.
Right, the runoff.
But yeah, only 23% of people voted.
Right.
So I guarantee less than half the people who are out there protesting for this pro-choice went out and voted for their senators. I doubt that. Less than half, probably even out of those group of people, only maybe 10 or 5% went out there and voted for the senators that are going to decide on whether abortion is going to be legal in your state or not. So I actually think, I'm over here watching these videos, people are yelling, oh, it's my body, my choice. Well, congratulations, they just gave you the choice. They gave you the more of a choice to do it. Now imagine if they would have overturned it in the federal level. Abortions are illegal in the United States.
Everywhere in the United States, right.
Then I'll be understanding, like, okay, go crazy, because this is a country where mostly only two political parties stand. Right. So we would be a country divided if they would have did it on the federal level where you just can't have abortions at all. Because you're not really speaking for the whole country. Right. But they put it down to the state level so the people... I like how they did this, because I kind of... The way I view government, I would rather like it to be more of like each state is its own province with its own laws. So now we have our own laws that we can decide on for the people we live around in our communities, mm-hmm. and in our states. Mm-hmm. We're given more power. Mm-hmm. So people are protesting because the federal government gave us more power to decide on what we get to vote on. And we don't get to directly vote for that law, but you can absolutely please go and vote for the representative that's gonna push, you know, switching over to making abortion legal or illegal. It's always gonna be illegal in Alabama, but I mean in like states like that switch every election to red and blue. There's states like that.
Right. Yeah.
Florida, they switch almost every year.
Yeah.
Every election.
Right.
So in states like that, just go out there and vote. It's a voting thing. And that's what really kind of got me upset. I'm like, what are they upset about? Because we have more power as a people, as a state. We have more power to decide what you want. And you can't say, I can't have abortion because I live in this state. Yo, you can move. And you can't be like, oh, I'll have to leave everything. I don't have a job. The effects of COVID are still lasting. There are jobs everywhere. There's more people unemployed and more employers looking for jobs than ever. It's the state of the economy right now.
Right.
You can literally move from a different state and get a better job that you have now. If you're that crazy about abortion, which is crazy if you're that crazy about abortion. If you're that crazy about abortion where you feel like having an abortion is critical to your health care, then you're just living a promiscuous life. I had to say it. Someone had to say it. If you're that crazy about abortion to the point where it's a necessity for you to have that option, because that means you live a promiscuous life. Now, I understand this is where my views falter, because I strictly believe in not having abortions because of my religious standpoint in life.
Okay.
But I understand the argument where it comes to, like, if you were sexually assaulted or molested or anything like that, and you had an unconsensualized child, in that case, and I know this is not aligned with yours, I do believe that you should be able to have an abortion.
Okay.
But when it comes to having an abortion because of the inconvenience of the child after consensual sex, I don't believe in that at all. And like you said, it takes two to lay down. And in most cases, in all cases, and I know a lot of people who don't notice at all, I know it's the woman's body, and I'm all for women having choice over their body. I don't care about what a woman does with her body. I care about the baby inside of her body and how that baby's going to affect society in the future. I looked up the numbers earlier last night. There are 334 million abortions in 2021. 334 million. And you know, and I think the UK or Canada came in second. And guess what their numbers were? 62 million. We blew them out the water. This is mass genocide. I went from the 334 million and figured out what kind of minority or who has the most abortions. Out of those abortions, 334 million, 150 million were Black Americans. This is mass genocide, and we just walk over it.
So let me get this straight for our viewers here. So what you're saying is 300 plus million babies were killed last year.
Yes.
Fiscal
for
year
abortion.
By abortion.
Okay.
300 million plus million babies. 300 million lives were snuffed out. And almost half of those numbers were Black babies.
Yes.
It's now, did those statistics say, well, they probably can't, how many were just because they didn't want them or by rape or anything? They probably didn't say that. But anyways, and it doesn't matter. That is an awesome revelation to know, because some people may not know that, and all it did was a Google search, that those are the numbers. And see, that's important that my son brought that up, because people need to understand what's going on. And 300 plus million babies last year were killed by abortion. 300 million. And in the second place countries, it was only approximately 60 million. We tripled, give or take, killing of babies. He uses the right term. It's a mass genocide of generations of people. Mm-hmm. Whether you're Black, white, Hispanic, Asian, whatever. It's a mass genocide of babies, because every baby has a potential to be great. Mm-hmm. Now to talk about when you talk about rape and, you know, rape, sexual molestation, those type of things. My thing is this: I understand that a lot of states are going to put that in there, but even in rape, and I'm just throwing it out here for argument's sake, is the child guilty of the act that happened?
No, but it's from my understanding, because I would never be in this position in my life. But okay. I made sure I did the research before I came on here today.
Okay, good.
And I watched the video concerning why people get abortions after rape, and they're saying that that when you say, okay, let's use an analogy.
Okay, go ahead. Make your point.
So let's say I come to your house and rob you. We live in the same house, by the way. I come to your house and rob it, right? Okay. I take your stuff, I get caught. Wouldn't you want your stuff back? Wouldn't you want your life to be the exact life you left it before you got robbed?
I get it.
It's the same thing. Before she was the victim of a crime, she'd want her life to be exactly how it was as possible. It's never going to be the same because she's traumatized.
I got it.
But she would want her life to go back to as close as it was before she was a victim of this crime.
Okay.
So that means a life without that baby.
Okay.
And then I know this is a very pro-choice opinion, but the baby is always going to remind her of that trauma that ensued when she was sexually assaulted, molested, or raped, or anything like that. And people say you can give it up to adoption, and we're going to see how this goes, because there's going to be a lot of
giving away. Oh, we're going to talk about that in just a minute.
There's going to be a lot of giving away to adoptions, which is good to a certain extent. It depends how big these numbers get. But definitely, even giving birth to the product of being a victim of such a traumatizing and crazy ordeal, I think is fair.
Okay.
I think it's fair.
Okay.
Most, you gotta realize that most of these 300, and you say you don't know the exact numbers for like rape and things like
right.
that. But I've looked at the statistics for countries that have, like, we have about 400 million people in America, and I'm gonna say that one more time. We have about 400 million people in America, and we killed almost 300 million. That's our population almost. But anyway, I looked at countries that have similar population as the United States of America, where abortion is illegal unless you were a victim of a crime. And those numbers are significantly low, even as goes down to as low as a almost 13,000.
Wow.
And they have similar, it's not exact because America's a big country, but I think it was like, I don't know if it was Russia or I don't know if it was Russia, but it was only 13,000.
Wow. So, and you know, Philip brought up a good point. And you know what? I would be persuaded to go with that. I think that was a very good argument for that. And I've never been hardcore about that. I've been kind of betwixt and between about that. Because I guess because I focus on the baby, because the baby's innocent. But I get, the way my son put it is a good argument. And it's unfortunate that the media can't make that same type of argument. Because they don't. Because it's all about what they believe in and what their ratings and what their agenda they're trying to push. They're not trying to make a cohesive argument about, well, you know what, you may want to consider this. And this is why we do this podcast. Because on that, we didn't necessarily disagree, but I was kind of on the fence. So, in that, the other thing I heard this morning by another YouTuber was that because of this, but the states are going to have to up their game when it comes to abortion laws, orphanages, and giving more to potentially contraception for both men and women. Because now the federal government's out of it. It's going to be up to the states now to make sure that there's a viable alternative to killing a child. In my opinion, life begins at conception. Yay. That's life. Other people have different views on when life begins, but for me, life begins at conception when the sperm hits the egg and fertilizes. That's life. Mm-hmm. Okay? That's when life begins, not when you have sex. That's not when life begins. Okay? Life begins when the egg goes into fertilizes, you know, sperm fertilizes the egg, so on. That's life. Life is supposed to be protected. As saints and Christians, we are about life, not death. Okay? We are about life. Okay? And my son gave you the numbers. Again, they're you know, last year's numbers, but because this fiscal year hasn't ended yet.
Right.
But we'll see how this fiscal year goes because, you know, we're about halfway through the fiscal year. Mm-hmm. So it's going to skew the numbers at the end of the fiscal year. But that's the kicker. What are the states that are making it a felony and illegal going to do as an option for them? How are they going to persuade people to not go either on the black market or move to another state to kill a child, except for in the case of a crime, or to save the mother's life, because sometimes you have to. Some pregnancies are very difficult, and if you don't remove the baby, the mother will die.
Right.
I agree with that. Okay, because the mother is the priority, because the mother can have more babies. Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's a real tough decision to make, but in reality, it's not. A mother can always have more babies,
yeah.
But if you don't do what you got to do to save the mother, then both die.
Yeah.
So I get that. I'm all for that, and I could be persuaded for the crime part too, because again, my son made a very cogent argument. But now the question is, Philip, can the states step up to the plate for the ones that are making it illegal, which are probably about half the states?
Yeah.
What are they going to do? Are they going to make adoption easier? Because adoption is absolutely nuts.
It's hard.
It's too difficult. So one, adoption is going to have to be made easier.
Yeah.
Two, foster care and orphanages, they're going to have to be redone, reevaluate, because there's so too many horror stories about foster care.
Yeah.
The state's going to totally have to redesign foster care. Mm. They're totally going to have to revamp it to make it much more, they're going to make it much easier for people to feel comfortable.
Much more human.
Human, exactly. Because, you know, there's too many horror stories out there for foster care. So that's going to have to totally be revamped. And states are going to have to make it easier for people to get quote-unquote contraception. Obviously, as Christians and saints, we don't believe in that. We understand that people do what people do because we have free will. We don't promote it, but we know it's out there. We, as Christians and saints, should believe in abstinence before marriage. That's the Bible. But we know reality is not everybody practices abstinence. So if you don't practice abstinence, then there at least should be things out there where you can protect yourself. Okay? Again, I believe in abstinence before marriage, but that's just me. But we have to be real about the fact that not everybody does it. Even Christians and saints don't believe it. So because we have people that are going to do what they want to do, because again, the Bible says God has given us free will. And because every human being has free will, people are going to do what they want to do. So because we know this, then we know that people should have the ability to be able to be protected. Just a basic medical need. Okay? So the states have to do better than this. So that's the other side of this decision. Yes, we who are pro-life are happy about this decision. We believe that it was a moral decision, that it was the best moral decision to make, that it was all those things. And we know that the pro-choice folk just totally disagree because they just believe in doing whatever you want. Well, freedom is great, but freedom is only as good as the moral compass in every individual. So let me use this as an example. If we just let everybody do whatever they want, that means there'll be no more laws, you know, and all this does. You know, we're a nation of laws too. Laws is how we keep ourselves a civilized society. But a lot of pro-life, pro-choice people are anarchists and just believe in doing whatever you want. And that's not how society is. I'm not saying all. Obviously, all that we see on television. But of course, that doesn't represent everybody who is a pro-choice person. I know pro-choice people that aren't like that, that aren't crazy like that. But I'm saying is this is what we have to do. You know, our Constitution is only as good as the enforcement behind it. And so laws are necessary, but so are morals. And I'm sure my co-host would agree, morals are very necessary in a society.
Right, this country was built on...
And founded on morals.
On the Christian morals of
correct,
society.
Even if the individuals who wrote it weren't necessarily Christian or moral in themselves.
And then the people who also instituted this country believed in the morals of John Locke, who wrote about natural rights and the humanitarian...
Correct, good book, by the way.
About every single person has their own natural right to have free will. And that's what started the Revolutionary War. So
right.
So we'll all agreeance in that everybody should have free will to the highest extent. That's fine. This is the Roe v. Wade overturning is not taking away your natural right to live, first of all, and it's not taking right your right of free will. You have as much free will to pack your stuff and move to California and live the life that you want to live to where you have to be concerned about an abortion like that, which is crazy to me. But I was also watching, obviously I want to say that pro-choice people are anarchists, not even the people on the TV. I feel like that this has been the highest political standpoint that the country has been in a long time. Like, this overturning has impacted United States society more than anything in the past 10, 20 years. Because this is big. Because people are connecting having the option to have an abortion with taking away healthcare rights. And that's just not true.
That's a lie.
That's just not true.
Straight up lie.
That's what the media says. And that's why, you know, after I did all this research for this thing, I deleted social media immediately. I was done. There's so much crazy stuff that the people and celebrities are trying to push out that are just completely not true. You will always have an option as an American, except for that the laws that are put in place to keep Americans safe, like obvious ones, like you are going to jail if you commit a crime, a heinous crime, or even a little crime. Those are to protect the Americans and the country that we live in. But passing laws like this, people don't understand, is also protecting future.
It's protecting lives.
Future Americans.
Right.
And I brought this up earlier this month, is that, you know, right now, the elderly that live in this country have Social Security, which are paid for by the taxes of the generation below them that still work. And I was looking into something a couple weeks ago, and it stated that at the rate abortions were going, and this was just occurred a couple weeks ago, because once again, if we're killing over 300 million, our population is 400 million, we're literally killing over half the future population. So if we're killing off half the future population, we won't have enough people to collect taxes from the past generation to have Social Security in our elderly lives. We wouldn't have that at all, because there wouldn't be enough people working or enough tax money to be taken from to take care of the elderly and the people who can't work and unemployment and like reasonable unemployment and stuff like that. So this is also this overturning where abortions are legal, and you know, even where in states where it is illegal, they're still gonna do it. It's just like when they pass this day, people are acting like Roe v. Wade was decided in a day. They've been talking about this since January of this year.
We've been fighting this for decades.
And they just like,
but since the leak.
January. They've been doing this for months.
Right.
And people are saying, oh, they would take away the choice of a woman, but they can't take away guns. They've been working on this for probably years, and it just got out in January that it's going to be a possibility that is overturned. They've been working on this for years. They haven't been working on new gun law systems since the early 2000s. So, I don't
know. And I think the House just passed. I think the president is about to sign a new gun law. I don't know the extent of it. But anyways, there's no way you can compare the two. It's absolutely ridiculous. Nobody has lost a choice. A woman still has a choice to do whatever she wants to with her own body. Yeah. You just not now be able to do it in the state that you live in. And there's always going to be people out there that are going to do it, of course, for money now.
Yeah.
There's going to be a black market out there. It's not going to be regulated. It's not going to be safe.
Gonna die,
but you know, guess what? You still have the choice to get one. Mm-hmm. Even in a state that makes it illegal. There's still going to be people out there. No, they're gonna have to be hidden now. They can't be up front anymore. So all these folk here in Alabama and there used to be a clinic near the university that I work near next to. There are several of them over there. They'll probably all have to close down. They have to go underground or whatever. They're still gonna be there. We can't emphasize this point enough. Your choice is your choice, and you still have a choice. It doesn't affect your health care. It doesn't affect any of that stuff. It just means that if you want to do it legally, you have to move to another state, whether it be on the West Coast or Northeast, California, Oregon, Washington, New Mexico, Illinois, New York, Massachusetts, you know, all them states that are very liberal.
Yeah.
Okay, go move there. That's fine. Go do you. As my son said, there are jobs everywhere. Everybody's trying to hire somebody. So there's no excuses. You can't make the excuse that I can't financially do it, because you could probably, as he stated, go to another state and probably get a better job, because so many people are trying to hire. And if you don't see that, then you're under a rock somewhere. And to my point, as far as the anarchists, I'm just talking about the people we see on television. They're absolutely wild and crazy,
oh, yeah,
stripped down naked. It's just ridiculous.
It's people who are throwing bottles at the Capitol.
Right. I mean, this is just ridiculous. Okay, we know that the majority, even pro-choice, are hopefully, just regular
reasonable
people that they believe in what they believe in.
Right, it's just like you and me, we just have opinions.
Right, this is just our opinion, okay? Whether you agree with it or not is irrelevant. Mm-hmm. This is just our opinion. If you agree with it, great. If you don't, that's fine. And if you don't agree with it, you know what I'm saying? Don't just cuss us out and do whatever because you don't agree with it. Have a cogent argument to what you believe in, because you'll get deleted off the comments. We're not going to deal with that. We want cogent arguments. People who actually have some doggone sense and some intelligence.
I don't want to delete you. I'm just responding. Mine is strictly religious based. So
well, my son will respond to you, but I won't. Okay? But what we're trying to foster here is conversation. That's the whole point of this podcast, is to foster conversation. We have our views, you have your views. That's great. Let's come together and discuss it. Let's talk about it. Let's be reasonable. And in the end, let's just agree to disagree if all else fails. You know what I'm saying? That's the great thing about living in a country that we live in. We can have an opinion and disagree. Well, unless you're on social media, then you can't. If you don't agree with the mob, then you're going to get canceled because we live in that type of culture.
I thought someone got canceled last night.
That's what I'm saying. You know, and that's, and the reality is they wouldn't do that to the person in person because they're cowards. Mm-hmm. They can do it on the internet because there's no accountability and there's no consequences. But face that person face to face and see if you cancel. I guarantee the majority of them wouldn't do it. Mm-hmm. The internet gives people that power. And in reality, it's too much power. But guess what? You have the freedom to do that. Our laws allow you to do that. Just like our laws allow you to kill your baby. That's your choice. I ain't got to agree with it, but that's your choice. And so now, as my son so aptly put it, you have even more of a choice to dictate how your state views this subject.
Just vote.
Go vote. And go vote for people that you agree with or that agree with you. That's how you change things, believe it or not. Even in a representative republic. Because guess what's gonna and guess what's gonna happen in November?
The big election for senators, right?
Right. The midterms.
Yeah.
I guarantee you that this decision.
I'm voting.
This decision, yeah, because he'll be old enough. This decision will change the landscape of our country in midterms.
I bet a lot.
Whether you believe it was done on purpose or not is irrelevant. It is great timing, yes. It's definitely not a coincidence. But like my son said, this is a thing that's been brewing for decades. It just so happened that the quote-unquote
leak,
you know, well, the leak was one, but it was happening even before the leak.
Yeah, it's been
happening for that person that leaked it,
5 years.
That person that leaked it does need to be arrested and put in jail because that was that he violated the law.
He or she
violated the law
on a huge level.
On a huge level, and they will find out who that person is eventually.
Yeah,
and he or she will be prosecuted, and as well they should be.
It's like they prosecuting everybody on that went to the Capitol on January 6th.
Correct.
They get them like this.
Correct.
Every day they locking up 5 people.
Correct. So the simple fact of the matter is yes, some people believe that this decision was done purposely to take away from the January 6th.
It's not that deep.
It's not even that deep. It really isn't. That January 6th stuff is not going to...
They were deciding things like this before.
Right. The January 6th thing is just a show. That's all it is a show.
But they sure getting punished for it. These people getting 5 to 10 years.
Right. Again, whether they're guilty or not is irrelevant.
I mean, they raided the Capitol.
Right. I'm not taking a side on that because in the end, you know, that's for people...
That's treason.
Well, we can disagree on that. We'll talk about that in another podcast.
Here we go.
Okay, we can talk about January 6th in another podcast. But whether you agree with it or not, it is not taking away from that. I think it's just a sideshow, to be perfectly honest. The thing on television they're doing on television, that's just a sideshow. I'm not trying to downplay the importance of what they're doing, but they're like a lot of things in society, they're doing it for political reasons. They're doing it for their own agendas. They're doing it for all this other stuff. Because not everybody that was out there on January 6th rolled into the Capitol.
A lot of people did, though.
A small percentage of the people that are outside.
That was a lot of people, though.
But see, again, we're talking about abortion here.
Okay. Go back.
It'll come back. We're talking about abortion in that... you know, that a small or a certain percentage of the population always drives agendas, regardless of what side you believe in.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I've heard some argument that the minority always will rule because, you know, the rich really run this country and all this other stuff. And okay, you know.
I feel like this silent majority won in this case. I know more people... Even believe it or not, a pro-life and pro-choice. It's just that pro-choice is the most popular because that's what they're selecting.
The pro-choice, you're right. I believe more people are pro-life in this country than pro-choice, but the pro-choice are louder.
Yeah, because they're celebrities.
Because they're celebrities and they have money.
So I feel like the sound of the majority win in this case. And I feel like this is a good track, especially if you're conservative or Republican. I think they're going back on that
track. Or do you just have morals? You don't even have to be a conservative or Republican. There are liberals out there that actually have morals.
Christian morals.
There are Democrats that have morals.
Christian morals go on the side of conservatism, sadly.
Right, and I get that they're linked. I get it. I think that you know, to tie all this up, I think that the great numbers that my son has given puts everything in perspective. I think that in reality, all this protesting going on is all for show. It's all for show.
Those people didn't even
all vote. The people in California going into stores and stealing and looting. It's just an excuse for people to commit crimes.
Yep.
And we know it's already legal on the West Coast. They can go in a store and steal up to a certain amount and the police won't even do nothing. So really, they've legalized theft. So, I mean, it's the Wild West out there on the West Coast. Literally. And in the Northeast, and in a lot of cases.
A lot of homeless, too.
Yeah. You know? And so, this is just one aspect of a greater thing that potentially will happen down the road. I've heard, Philip, that they say this is going to start an avalanche of other big cases coming down the pike. Gay marriage. Brown versus Board of Education. They're going to overturn that, which I think is... will never happen. I think that's people that want to inject racism in this, and it's absolutely stupid. Abortion has nothing to do with race, and for the folk that are screaming racism, they're killing more your people than they are mine. Let's just be real about it. You scream racism, and they have elected officials out there that are injecting racism in this, but the ones like Maxine Waters is your people that are being disproportionately affected by abortions.
150.
So how are you doggone going to scream that it's racist for abortions to be illegal when one, it's not, it may not be illegal in the state that you live in. In fact, it's probably not illegal in D.C. where they're screaming and crying about it.
Yeah.
In fact, it'll be legal in D.C. It'll probably be legal in Virginia, too.
Yeah.
Virginia's one of them states that flips back and forth. Mm-hmm. It used to be a very, very red state. Now it's a blue state. Mm-hmm. Or a purple state, as they like to call it. So, what are you crying about? Okay? You and whoever you believe in can go and kill their baby whenever they feel like it. Depending on what state you live in. But I believe, as my son does, that... ever since Roe versus Wade was made legal on a federal level, that this country has conducted a mass genocide of our future. And we are where we at today, a very old population, because we're killing our friggin' youth and our future. Just let that sink in for a minute. We have conducted a mass genocide of our future, and it's been done on purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Let's be real about it. It's not no accident. Mm-hmm. This is done on purpose. The founder of Planned Parenthood, a woman, said that this was done to conduct genocide on a certain population of people, minorities. She was a white woman.
Black.
But nobody wants to talk about that.
13%. This always confused me. America, from almost the beginning of when this country was made, always had black people in it. At some point in the South, they had more black people than they had white people because of slavery. Mm-hmm. So my confusion is, out of all these years and generations we've been in America, how out of the population are we only 13%? And it's because we are killing more than half, we're almost half of the people who are killing in abortion.
So let me say this to
13% of the people of America are killing most of the babies. They're doing it themselves.
So we just celebrated Juneteenth for all who celebrate it. You know, that's your choice.
Right.
For all who celebrate it. Since basically it's the celebration of the end of slavery, but really it was a general telling the folk in Texas, oh, by the way, you're free now. And... it depended on if you believe it started in Texas, some people, you know, whatever. Anyways, but I think that's the date that they use is the date that particular general went to the coast of Texas and told the slaves, oh, by the way, you're free.
Yeah.
Okay. But since the end of slavery, since Jim Crow and all these other laws that were meant to still consider black people in this country second-class citizens, if you really look at it, all they did was change the narrative. So instead of having Jim Crow laws or and all these other names they give these laws, and I'm not as versed as you might be on them, all they did is say, you know what? We don't have to have these laws anymore. We don't even have to treat them as second class citizens. We'll just make abortion legal, and that's how we can get rid of them. So for all y'all that are screaming racism, and yes, racism does exist, you'd be naive to say it doesn't. Abortion is basically like the new slavery. Heck, your phones probably make you more of a slave than the slaves back in the day.
Yeah, there's a book, it's called Neo-Slavery.
Right, exactly. That might be a book he recommends down the road.
Yeah, podcast.
But I would argue that abortion has killed more black babies than any slave that died during slavery times.
Oh.
This country has conducted a mass genocide of predominantly black babies, and of course we know white babies are aborted, and Hispanic babies, and Asian babies.
Just
we know
the majority
that.
Are black.
But do your homework like my son did. Look at the statistics, Google it, and you'll find out. So all y'all screaming racism about what this person is doing, what this person is not, and complaining about this person and this law and all this other stuff, never complain that abortions are killing your future more than anything in this country, in this country's history. We have killed so many future leaders of this country. It is absolutely atrocious. It is a sin. And this is the funny thing, Philip. If somebody were to kill a pregnant mother, they don't just give them one count of murder, they give them two counts of murder.
Mm.
So how is it that killing a pregnant mother is more important than killing a baby? Y'all think about that and ponder that for a second.
I think that's a good way to top it off.
That's a good way to top it off right there.
All right. Well,
you know what? And you know what? We could talk about this all day long, but we're going to leave it right there because my co-host said that was a good time to top it off. So just give you something to think about, and that's all this podcast is doing. That's all the Weight of the World podcast is doing. It's make you think, make you talk. Let's have a discussion. Let's talk about it as civilized human beings. We don't have to agree because that's a beautiful thing. We're not all robots. So with that, Philip, what's your book recommendation for this episode number 2?
Man, I feel like this is a great way to put our opinions out here, you know, but without giving any care of what other people think. We just put our opinion out here.
Right.
And I got that personally from a book called The Courage to Be Disliked. I forgot the author, but I'll put it in the description. But it's called The Courage to Be Disliked, and I'll put it on the screen too, right here. And y'all can check that out if y'all want. It talks more about like separation of tasks. It's a lot of philosophy too, like why you should live your life in a way that benefits you more than it benefits the beliefs of others and things like that.
So, interesting.
I'll definitely put that in the description and on the screen.
All right. And again, this subject brings all kinds of stuff. We're going to talk about accountability. That's going to be a big series coming. But we had to talk about abortion today because it's the big hot topic, especially in my generation. It's it's the biggest thing that's happened in our generation probably ever. You know, and I was born during Vietnam, so that's saying something. So, you know, it's a big deal. So, we thank you, for all that are going to come and listen. We don't want you to be offended by anything we say. If you are, that's on you, but we just want you to think about what we're saying, whether you agree or not. That's cool. It doesn't matter. It's cool. Because your opinion is just as valid as ours. And that's what we lose in a society, is that everybody's opinion is valid. My son brought the numbers and the statistics, which is important. So that's a good thing. And, you know, my son is just so super smart. And so I'm very thankful for him bringing the numbers. And I'm glad he did. But that's why he's a producer and an editor, because he does his research. And I kind of knew he would. So I'm glad he did it. So, again, on behalf of myself and my son, we're thankful for you watching this show. We're thankful for the ones that are going to watch this show. We're thankful for the comments, the likes. Oh, make sure you like, subscribe. Okay. And touch the little bell, there are notifications. when you watch this episode number 2 of the Way of the World podcast, okay? Make sure you do that now, because that'll get more and more people watching this, and then we can really get people to start having conversation. And that's what this is all about, just people having conversations. And so until the next time, until episode number 3, God bless you, and we will see you on the next episode.